morning, students. Hope you are fine and taking good care of yourself. Now I begin with the second part of the chapter, the best Christmas present in the world. But before I start with the second part, let's have a quick recap of what we read in the first part. The narrator bought a desk from an antique shop. While repairing, he saw a secret drawer and found a letter. He read the letter. It was written by Jim Macpherson to his wife, Connie. Jim was a soldier of British Army and he was deployed to fight against German Army. In his letter, Jim had described an evening at the war front. At the war front, instead of fighting, both British as well as the German armies celebrated Christmas Eve together merrily. They were making peace at war. You cannot imagine, dearest Connie, my feelings as I looked into the eyes of the Fritz officer who approached me hands outstretched. Children, underline the word outstretched. It means with stretched arms or with open arms. Hans Wolf, he said, gripping my heart warmly and holding it. I am from Dusseldorf. Dusseldorf is a place in Germany from where Hans Wolf hailed. I play the cello in the orchestra. Underline the word cello. You can see it in the glossary. It's a musical instrument with a large violin. In the orchestra, Happy Christmas. Captain Jim Macpherson, I replied, and a Happy Christmas to you too. I'm a school teacher from Dorset in the west of England. Ah, Dorset. He smiled. I know this place. I know it very well. We shared my rum ration and his excellent sausage. Sausage is a piece of meat and it is formed in a cylindrical shape. You may underline this word and write down the meaning also. And we talked. Connie, how we talked. He spoke almost perfect English, but it turned out that he had never set foot in Dorset, never even been to England. He had learned all he knew of England from school and from reading books in English. His favorite writer was Thomas Hardy. His favorite book, Far From the Madding Crowd. So there in no man's land, we talked of Bathsheba and Gabriel O and Sergeant Troy and Dorset. Children, I had already explained to you this term, no man's land. It's a part of the ground which is between the two borders of the countries or states. That part of the land does not fall in any of the territories. Now, the words like Bathsheba, Gabriel Oak, Sergeant Troy, these are all the characters of the plays or the books which they had read. And since they had read common books, so they are here discussing about these characters. Dorset, of course, is the place from where Jim had come. He had a wife and one son, born just 6 months ago. As I looked about me, there were huddles of khaki and grey everywhere. Underline the word huddles. Huddles means a crowd of people, a gathering of people. All over no man's land, smoking, laughing, talking, drinking, eating. Hans Wolf and I shared what was left of your wonderful Christmas cake, Connie. He thought the marzipan was the best he had ever tasted. Underline the word marzipan. You can see in the glossary also, marzipan is a sweet covering on a cake made from sugar, eggs and almonds. This particular dish is specially made on Christmas. I agreed. We agreed about everything and he was my enemy. There never was a Christmas party like it, Connie. Okay, in this part of the story, we now understand that Hans Wolf, the German soldier, and Jim Macpherson, the British soldier, came face to face and introduced themselves. Hans Wolf was a German soldier, also nicknamed as Fritz. Because German soldiers were given this term as Fritz. So I am using this word because it's already used in the chapter. So Hans Wolf used to live in Dusseldorf and he used to play cello in an orchestra. Whereas Jim Macpherson was a teacher in Dorset in the west of England. And when they introduced themselves, Hans Wolf could relate himself to the place Dorset where Jim worked because he had already been there. And also, being a German, he could speak flawless English, which Jim really appreciated. Both of them started talking to each other. Both of them shared their views on the books they read, the authors about whom they had read, the plays that they saw, and the things that they liked. So after this conversation between Jim and Hans, they understood that there were so many things in common between them. And they were like no more enemies. They were as good as good old friends. Then someone, I don't know who, brought out a football. Great coats were dumped in piles to make goal posts. And the next thing we knew, it was Tommy against Fritz. Tommy, I told you earlier also, this is a nickname given to British soldiers. And Fritz is the nickname given to German soldiers. So both the armies, Tommy's and Fritz, they were out in the middle of no man's land. Hans Wolf and I looked on and cheered, clapping our hands and stamping our feet to keep out the cold as much as anything. There was a moment when I noticed our breaths mingling in the air between us. Underline the word mingling. Mingling means mixing up with each other, which means they were so close to each other, there was a moment that they could actually feel their breaths mixing in the air between them. He saw it too and smiled. Jim Macpherson, he said after a while, I think this is how we should resolve this war. Resolve. Underline the word resolve. Resolve means to solve a matter, solving an issue. A football match, no one dies in a football match. No children are orphaned. Underline the word orphaned. Orphans are those who do not have parents. No wives become widows. Widow. Widow is a woman who has no husband. I would prefer cricket, I told him. Then we Tommies could be sure of winning, probably. We laughed at that and together we watched the game. Sad to say, Kony, Fritz won. 2-1. But as Hans Wolf generously said, our goal was wider than theirs, so it wasn't quite fair. Children, you can look in this picture also how the two armies are playing with each other. One team is wearing khaki dress and the other is wearing a green colored dress, and that's how they were distinguished in this picture. And if you see that other soldiers are cheering them, they are motivating them and stamping their feet to encourage them to play. The time came, and all too soon, when the game was finished, the schnapps, I told you this word earlier also, schnapps is a kind of drink, and the rum is also kind of a drink, and the sausage also, I just explained, it's a kind of meat, had long since run out, the phrase, verbal phrase run out is, it run out actually means that they had finished. Run out means to finish. And we knew it was all over. I wished Hans well and told him I hoped he would see his family again soon, that the fighting would end and we could all go home. And then someone came up with this idea of playing football match between the two armies. Everybody agreed to it and they took off their coats and made goalposts on the two sides of the ground and they played football. As they were playing football, Hans Wolf just told Jim Macpherson, wouldn't it be nice if all the issues or all the fights are resolved by just playing a match instead of fighting a war? Jim McPherson also agreed to it, and it was a very deep thought which Hans Wolf had in his mind. Anyways, the match got over, and as usual, the Fritz won the match. But there again, Hans Wolf was very humble in saying that they could win the match because their goalpost was wider, and it was unfair for the Tommies to not win that match. Now the game was over, the drinks, the eatables, everything was done, and the party was almost finished and over, and it was time for the two armies to go back to their places. Both of them, Hans Wolf and Jim McPherson, wished each other well, and they both wished for each other that they should be able to see their families very soon. I think that is what every soldier wants. On both sides, Hans Wolf said, "Take care, Jim McPherson. I shall never forget this moment, nor you." He saluted and walked away from me slowly, unwillingly. Underline the word unwillingly. It means one doesn't want to do but has to do perforce. Unwillingly means doesn't want to do. I felt. He turned to wave just once and then became one of the hundreds of grey-coated men drifting back towards their trenches. Drifting. Drifting means moving away. You can underline this word and write the meaning. Moving away. Trenches, I told you in the last part also, trenches is pits which are dug in the ground so that the soldiers can stand there and aim at enemies. That night, back in our dugouts, dugouts are the same as trenches. It's another word for that. We heard them singing a carol and singing it quite beautifully. It was Still Not. Still Not is the name of the song, and in English it's called as Silent Night. It's a name of the carol which they were singing. Our boys gave them a rousing chorus of While Shepherds Watched. Now here, both the armies are singing their carols. The German was singing Silent Night, while the British were singing While Shepherds Watched. We exchanged carols for a while and then we all felt silent. We had had our time of peace and goodwill, a time I will treasure as long as I live. Dearest Connie, my Christmas time next year, this war will be nothing but a distant and terrible memory. I know from all that happened today how much both armies long for peace. Underline the word long here. Here in this context, the word long means wait. We shall be together again soon. I'm sure of it. Your loving, Jim. So they all went back to their trenches, to their original places, but they all did not sleep that night. Entire night, the Christmas night, the Christmas Eve, they kept singing carols. They exchanged carols with each other. Carols are the songs which the Christians sing in the church, and it's kind of worship of their God Jesus. And Jim here in the end part of the letter agrees that this was the best way to resolve any issue between the two countries. The joy, the happiness that he achieved here, he experienced here, not just he, Hans Wolf and his army also, was priceless. And what would happen, how the world would be like if all, you know, everywhere there is peace around, everywhere there's no fighting, and people are really friendly and happy with each other. The last part of the letter tells that Jim here has promised Connie McPherson that next Christmas Eve he'll definitely be at home and will be with her to celebrate the festival. That was a promise which Jim made in the letter for Connie, and this particular promise will be the foundation of what we are going to read in the next part of the story. Now we begin reading the third part of the story. I folded the letter again and slipped it carefully back into its envelope. I kept awake all night. By morning, I knew what I had to do. I drove to Bridport, just a few miles away. I asked a boy walking his dog where Copper Beaches was. If you remember, children, Copper Beaches was the address which was written on the envelope of the letter for Coney. House number 12 turned out to be nothing but a burned out shell. Underline the word burnt out. Look here in the glossary. Burned out means destroyed by fire. The roof gaping. Underline the word gaping. Gaping means open. The roof was all open. The house was all burnt out because of the fire. The windows boarded up. Underline the phrase boarded up, which means in the glossary covered with wooden boards. I knocked at the house next door and asked if anyone knew the whereabouts of Mrs. Macpherson. Oh yes, said the old man in his slippers. He knew her well. A lovely lady, he told me. A bit muddle-headed. Underline muddle-headed. Muddle-headed means confused. But at her age, she was entitled to be, wasn't she? 101 years old. So children, Coney was 101 years old. She was too old to be stable mentally also. And also because of what she had undergone, it was quite natural for her to be muddle-headed, means confused. She had been in the house when it caught fire. No one really knew how the fire had started, but it could well have been candles. She used candles rather than electricity because she always thought electricity was too expensive. The fireman had got her out just in time. She was in a nursing home now. He told me, Burlington House in Dorchester Road on the other side of town. So the old man gave him the address of the nursing home where Coney was kept. It was in Burlington House on Dorchester Road on the other side of town. I found Burlington House, her nursing home, easily enough. There were paper chains in the hallway and lighted Christmas tree stood in the corner with a lopsided angel on top. Paper chains. You understand what are paper chains? These are the decorations made with the help of paper. You must have seen the chain kind of thing made with paper and put on the walls as decoration. Lopsided. Lopsided. Underline this word. Lopsided means tilted to one side. Not straight, tilted. An angel is, of course, the figure or a small statue of angel with wings. They put on the Christmas tree for decoration. I said I was a friend, come to visit Mrs. Macpherson to bring her a Christmas present. I could see through into the dining room where everyone was wearing a paper hat and singing. The matron had a hat on too and seemed happy enough to see me. Matron. Matron is the head of the nursing home who looks after the residents there. She even offered me a mince pie. Mince pie is a non-vegetarian, a meat dish. She walked me along the corridor. Mrs. Macpherson is not in with the others, she told me. She's rather confused today. So we thought it best if she could have a good rest. She has no family, no one visits. So I'm sure she'll be only too pleased to see you. She took me into a conservatory with wicker chairs and potted plants all around and left me. Conservatory is a room. It's a kind of greenhouse. Have you ever seen a glass house covered, totally made up of glass, and there are plants kept inside. That kind, such kind of a room will only take sunlight, and the plants really grow nicely there. It's also called as a greenhouse with wicker chairs. Wicker chairs. What are wicker chairs? These are wicker is a kind of flexible branch of the plants, and these plants are taken out of the plants and they are made, they are woven together with the help of which they make chairs, somewhat like cane chairs or cane furniture. Jim MacPherson finished reading the letter, but he could not sleep that night. Whole night he kept on thinking what to do. And the next day morning he knew what to do. He took his car and he went to search for Coney. He went to that particular address, but when he went there, he found nothing but a house which was damaged in fire. He did not understand anything, so he went to her, Coney's neighbor, to ask what had happened about her. The neighbor told him that Coney was such a fine lady, she was a wise lady, but lately she had become a little muddle-headed. Muddle-headed means a person who is very confused. And one fine evening, the house caught fire, and she thought that it must have been actually the candles, because she did not use electricity since electricity was very expensive and she could not fend for it. So maybe because of the candles, the house must have got fire, must have caught fire, and because it caught fire, everything was damaged, the house was burnt, and she was then shifted to a nursing home where she was being treated. That nursing home was away from the town. It was at a place called Dorchester, and the narrator decided to go to that nursing home to meet her. So he went to that nursing home and he found that the entire hallway of the nursing home, the hall, everything was well decorated because of the Christmas festival. But Coney was not there. There was a nurse who helped him to go to her room, Coney's room. And while they were on their way, the nurse told him that Coney was not feeling fine on that particular day. Probably she was confused. And so they thought that she requires rest, and they had kept her in a separate room. Now in the next part of the story, let's see what happens when narrator sees Coney and they interact with each other. The old lady was sitting in a wheelchair, her hands folded in her lap. She had silver white hair pinned into a wispy bun. Wispy, underline this, wispy means not very neat. Untidy. And bun is a kind of hairstyle which women generally make. If you see in the picture, this is Coney who is sitting in the wheelchair. She has grey hair and her hair are all tied in a bun. The hairstyle is of a bun. She was gazing out at the garden. Gazing means to look out. "Hello," I said. She turned and looked up at me vacantly. Vacantly here means lost, completely lost. "Happy Christmas, Coney," I went on. "I found this. I think it's yours." As I was speaking, her eyes never left my face. I opened the tin box and gave it to her. That was the moment her eyes lit up with recognition, and her face became suffused with a sudden glow of happiness. Underline the phrase lit up. It's in the glossary here. Became bright and with happiness, excitement. Then underline the phrase suffused with. Suffused means spread all over her face. The glow of happiness spread everywhere on her face. I explained about the desk, about how I found it out, but I don't think she was listening. For a while, she said nothing but stroked the letter tenderly with her fingertips. Underline the word tenderly. Tenderly means gently. Suddenly, She reached out and took my hand. Her eyes were filled with tears. "You told me you would come home by Christmas, dearest," she said. "And here you are, the best Christmas present in the world. Come closer, Jim dear. Sit down." I sat down beside her and she kissed my cheek. "I read your letter so often, Jim, every day. I wanted to hear your voice in my head. It always made me feel you were with me. And now you are. Now you're back. You can read it to me yourself. Would you do that for me, Jim dear? I just want to hear your voice again. I would love that so much. And then perhaps we'll have some tea. I have made you a nice Christmas cake, marzipan, all around. I know how much you love marzipan." When the narrator went inside the room, he saw a lady sitting in the wheelchair. Her hair were white, they were grey, and they were all pinned up in a bun. The lady looked a little confused and unhappy, a little sad. And that was Goni, children, who was sitting there waiting for her husband probably. Jim Macpherson went to her, he wished her Happy Christmas and kept that letter in her lap. And he started to explain how he found that letter and how he reached her. But Goni was so confused. When she saw the letter, that she was actually not listening. She was in some other world. She was lost in the thoughts of Jim. And which is why made her think that the person sitting in front of her was actually her husband. So she mistook narrator as her husband, Jim. She wasn't really listening to the Jim's words. And then later on in the end part of the story, she utters a few lines which are very touching. She says that she had read this letter so many times and now she is so happy that Jim is back and he has kept his promise. And she also said that she knew how much Jim liked marzipan and Christmas cake and all the sweets that she used to ever make, and she's made them once again. She also requested the narrator to read the letter because she wanted to hear that voice again and feel the love inside her. There was a glow of happiness on her face. The narrator did not have the nerves to tell her the truth. So he just kept sitting there, seeing how love can affect a person when it is understood and it is felt by the other one. So children, this part of the story has really made the title of the story so apt, so correct, justifiable. Because the best present that you can ever give to anyone in this world is happiness, good thoughts, good deeds. Other things are just material, they are temporary. But the feelings that one can carry, the feelings that you give to others is what matters the most. So the best Christmas present in the world was for Jim also, when he was in the war front and he had befriended his enemy, Hans Wolf. And the best Christmas present was for Koni also, that she got the happiness of her husband coming back. This was the story of this chapter. The summary of this chapter has already been done, we have discussed. And in the next part of my video, we will discuss the question answers and again try to summarize the points quickly. Till then, you will read the chapter and understand. Thank you, children. Have a good day. Students, here are the meanings of the words which are not given in the glossary of the chapter. These are extra words which I had explained to you. You may note them down in your book or anywhere, wherever you can remember later on.